Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon. My name is Deborah Spahr. I'm a professor at the Harvard Business School and an advisor to the X Fund. And it is my great pleasure to welcome you all here this afternoon. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you so much for dealing with a little bit more security than usual. But we have what will be, I'm sure, a wonderful afternoon's conversation in store for you. I'm particularly excited because the last time I was in this space, I was getting married. Dean for Business and Global Society at the Harvard Business School, which means along with my colleagues, I oversee all of the work that the school is doing at the intersection of business and society. And looking at all these corners of the world where business is involved in making an impact and changing things and hopefully pushing society in a more positive direction. A quick announcement that I do. At Biggs, we just launched, thanks to my colleague Drew Keller and others, our new website today. Please find us, please look at it. We are tracking all of the breaking developments at the corner of at the intersection of business and society. And we'll be doing maybe not things quite at this level on a regular basis, but other events that we think will be of interest to you all here today. But for today, we have two extraordinary human beings who will be in conversation with one another. Patrick Chung is a longtime friend of Harvard College, Harvard Law School, Harvard Business School. He was my student, and I've promised not to say how many years ago, but he was my student several years ago. He has gone on to an incredible career. He is the managing director of X Fund. X Fund, as many of you know, was co-founded along with the School of Engineering and Applied Science. It's built to back entrepreneurs who are investing in and creating some of the most interesting, innovative, and experimental technologies. Patrick also has the really interesting distinction of having been Sam Altman's first investor. So clearly somebody who can see the future and figure out how to invest in it. Sam Altman needs no introduction from me other than to say that it is our great pleasure on behalf of Harvard and CEES and Harvard Business School to invite to the stage Patrick.
Sam, you are very much in the news, so thank you so much for coming all this way.
Thank you for having me.
You know, we were just talking about the fact that we've known each other for almost 20 years. So what have you been up to lately? speaking of a long time ago, I have a gift. This is how we met. This was the very first pitch you ever gave for funding for your very first company.
I have not seen this since.
For a company called Viendo.
Wow.
And which would later become Looped. And so as you look at it, you know, like, if you could go back to the 19-year-old Sam Altman, what would you tell him not know today?
I think that you can just do stuff in the world, and this is not well taught. I certainly didn't know it when I was 19. I was certainly, you know, underambitious and working on the wrong thing. You learn quickly, but I wasn't sure about doing it at all. And I think the fact that the way that progress happens is people just work really hard and decide what they have conviction in and dedicate themselves to that, and that is like the only way that things happen and the world gets better, and that you don't need to like wait or you don't need to get permission, and you can sort of, even if you're like totally unknown in the world with almost no resources, you can still accomplish a surprising amount. I think that.
Did you not know that when you were 19? Because when I met you when you were 19, you certainly, that was certainly your attitude.
I figured it out fast. Once you like get going, you're like, oh, this is kind of how it works. But no, definitely not before starting the company.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So everyone is intensely interested about AI, OpenAI, the fate of humanity, and we'll get to all of that. But we have predominantly students in the audience today. And they look at you, and they aspire, and they dream to have the type. I think you're not even halfway done yet. And they wonder how. And so I want to back up just a little bit and think about your Marvel superhero origin story. So a 10th grade Sam Altman, can you just tell us a little bit about your, you know, how you grew up, your family life? What was a typical day in the life of a 10th grade Sam Altman?
I mean, I was just like a computer nerd. I don't know. Like, I sat at home playing on my computer.
What type of computer?
By that point, I had an iMac.
Okay.
Like a few generations in. Oh, and not literally like playing games, although I did that too. But I, you know, like trying to learn how to program and stuff like that. No, I had like a very normal high school life. I think there's nothing remarkable or interesting to say here. I went to school, I hung out with my friends, I played sports, and I like
what sports did you play?
My computer. I played water polo. That was what I did the most. I swam, I fenced.
You know how in the typical American like high school movie there are cliques, there are the jocks, there are the nerds, there are the like, were you part of one of those cliques?
More on the nerd side for sure.
Turned out well for you. Okay.
I liked sports a lot though, because never became as like venerated advice to the degree it should have, is this idea that you should try to be relentlessly resourceful. And that surprisingly often, if you just like keep looking for new attack vectors on a problem in front of you, you can figure it out. And I think this is one of like the most important skills in life. And it's surprisingly learnable or teachable, whatever you want to say. And it works like in almost all scenarios.
Can you give us an example of a time it worked?
I think even just to use the example that you were going out, you know, we needed to like figure out how to get a deal done with this mobile operator, and they didn't really work with startups or technology companies in general. And we probably tried 30 different paths into this company. At one point, the kind of the key decision maker said, I'm finally going to meet with you because I want you to like stop bothering us. It's like too many things, but like you can just like keep doing that until something works. And I think like most people at kind of like the first ignored email or the first like path where you don't find the right person into a company, or at least the second, would just stop. And I was probably like, I mean, it was like a life and death thing for our company, so we were very motivated to do it. But it was probably like, 30 different points of contact.
Why a not-for-profit?
I knew that like I wanted to do something with AI, but you gotta like rewind to the mindset of 2015. It was clear that there was something interesting happening with deep learning. And it was clear that it got better with more scale, and nothing else was clear. Like, we didn't know what we were going to do. We started the OpenAI, and the very first day, I remember so clearly, we sat around the room, like, looking at each other one morning, being like, okay, what now? We really had no idea what to do. We thought, let's do some research, let's come up with some papers, let's think of some ideas. Not only was like any product or revenue stream super far in our future, the idea of language models was super far in our future. The idea that we would like ever actually be able to make something people would want to use and was not just a paper that other people would implement was super far in our future. So if you start a for-profit, you have to like theoretically have some idea of and that there was something interesting here, and that led to GPT-1. And then somebody else said, well, you know, we have this thing about scale, let's scale it up to GPT-2.
And at this point in time,
are we all in some sort of cult? Like, how is this not like an earthquake to the world? But at that point, it was clear, like, let's go do GPT-3 and then 3.5 and 4.
So you had an insight at that point. Why isn't the rest of the world getting it?
Well, again, it seemed to me like ever since the sort of 2012 breakthrough, the world should have been paying much more attention. And then, yeah, there were all these other times along the way, GPT-2, the scaling loss paper, GPT-3, like, why does the world not get it? And then why it was GPT 3.5 that kind of finally had the moment where the world said, okay, we believe. I still don't know. And obviously, like, with the hallucination or general inaccuracy issues with ChatGPT, it seems like very reasonable to say it shouldn't do it. On the other hand, there are a lot of people in the world who can't afford legal advice. And if you can make it, even if imperfectly available, maybe it's better than not. And so what I'd like to do is get to a world where fundamentally, I think users are pretty smart, and as long as you disclaim things and explain them properly, I think people can make adult decisions. So what I'd like to get to is a world where we don't do things that have high potential for inaccuracies leading to misuse, but as the model gets better, that those are and those are kind of less common, we can give you a dial. And you can say, like, OpenAI should not be making those determinations. There should be a process by which society collectively negotiates, here's how we're going to use this technology. The rules should be uncomfortably permissive, but the defaults don't have to be so permissive. So I think it's fine to say the default is here. A user can cut. I guess, like, the question is, what do you hope society looks like when AGI gets built, or like how do you conceptualize the positive version of this? And my answer to that has like evolved quite a bit over time, but I'll give you my current thinking and I'm sure it'll change more. I'll start with my original conception. My original conception was at some point we like get over the threshold to this like self-improving superintelligence, and it's this magic thing in the tower that we